We were discussing MIPS. Just to remind you, it's a 64-bit processor, which fetches the codes and redeems for instructions every cycle. And we looked at the fetch and decode stage last time. Also looked at the branch predictor that it uses. So this processor uses a class of instructions called conditional instructions. We haven't discussed it earlier, so I thought I'll spend some time explaining what these are. So essentially the idea here is that if possible, we want to get rid of branches completely from the program. Because we have seen that branches cause problem in the future, unless you predict it properly. So, so take this particular piece of code, which says that if not A, then small a equal to small b. So this gets translated to that particular instruction, C move Z, which stands for conditional move of 0. And essentially what it does is that it moves the value in R3 to R2 provided R1 is 0. So essentially it converts the control dependence into a data dependence. Because now what we're essentially saying is that we have two sources for this instruction, which are R1 and R3. And R1 in a sense encodes the branch condition. It's called a predicate register. So essentially we have now more time to get R1 ready. Instead of in the future we now give it the execution stage. So what does it mean is that if we instead had a move instruction, of course your MIPS assembler will translate the move possibly to an add instruction with addition with 0. So suppose instead of this instruction, we have a simple move instruction, which moves R3 to R2, but before that, we have a branch instruction. So the code will roughly look like this if you do a bit translation of this. Branch is not equal to 0, R1 to label. Assume that R1 has A, capital A, and label will have something. And here you have move R2 comma R3. Assume that there is no branch in this one. Okay. Right, is that correct? Okay. So that's the translation of this code. So essentially, what would have happened is that this instruction gets fetched. So let's call this I1 and let's call this I2. So I1's timeline would be like this. So to be able to fetch I2 as opposed to I3, we need the outcome of this instruction here. Okay, we know that. Whereas if you look at that instruction, we can wait till the execution stage for R1 and R3 to get ready. Then only, the execution stage of these instructions will be stalled only if at least one of these is not ready, R1 and R3. So that's the meaning of this particular statement, that we have more time to get R1 ready instead of in the future we now need in the execution stage. So this is also known as if conversion. That's a technical term used in the compiler community. And very useful in compiling this piece of code. For example, if you want to say y equal to absolute of x, which is essentially this, right? If x less than 0, then y is minus x. So very useful in getting rid of hard to predict branches. For example, this could actually be a very hard to predict branch, depending on how the value of x varies. However, eliminating branches that guard a large piece of code may require too many conditional moves. So that may not be feasible actually. So this is normally tried on small pieces of conditional structures. and CMOOC set is supported by all processors today. Now the question is that how does it interact with register array? Okay. To understand why this is at all a problem, so we haven't yet looked at register array. So let's first try to see what the renamer does in BIPSRTET. Okay. So any question on conditional instructions? So this takes place in the second pipe stage, so it essentially has decode rename fused in a single pipe stage. And as we have discussed, every destination is assigned a new physical register from the free list. So this one we have already discussed in when discussing register name, how it works. Whenever you get a new instruction, the destination of the instruction will get a new physical register. For example, here, R3, R10, R4, R1, R3, R3, these are all destinations, they will get new physical registers from free list of registers. The sources are assigned the existing map. So for that, you have a table which maintains the current map of a logical register to a physical register. Okay. The map table is updated with a newly renamed destination. For every destination physical register, a busy bit is set high to signify that the value in this register is not yet ready. This bit is cleared after the instruction completes execution, but possibly before it happened. So this one also we have missed this particular protocol. How exactly renamer interacts with your register value bit. The integer and floating point instructions are assigned registers from two separate free lists because these are really disjoint register sets. The integer and FP register files are separate, so each has 64 registers. So notice that. BIPS has 32 logical registers for each of these, okay, and have double the number of physical registers. There is a slight complication involving bulk BIP. If you remember these two instructions, they have actually two destinations. Because if you multiply two 32-bit values, it will produce a 64-bit result. And that's normally split into the high and low registers. Right? Similarly, when you do a division, the quotient and remainder go to two different registers, high and low. The question is, how do I rename them? Because I don't have an option of renaming two destinations here in this particular protocol. So what BIPS does is that it first of all puts a restriction on. So as we said, it renames four instructions in a cycle, right? Now there is restriction on the position of the multiple instruction in the bucket. It cannot be put anywhere. Whenever it encounters a bulk or div instruction in the rename bundle, it actually terminates that bundle there. It cannot rename any further instruction. It breaks down this each of these instructions into two smaller instructions internally, and will rename them separately. So bulk will be broken down into two instructions, div will be broken down into two instructions, and they will go separately through the rename. However, their coupling will be maintained throughout the pipeline, that these two instructions are actually atomically coupled, right, as they flow through the pipeline. Any question on this basic protocol?
Why do you want to split this bulk and dev?
Because you have to rename two destinations, and here you don't have an option of doing that. The hardware allows you to rename only one destination every cycle. So from the free list, so the way the free list is designed in RTT is that it can provide you only four registers every cycle, four new registers at most, not more than that. Okay.
Why these constraints?
So the point is that what would be the other alternative? You would make it arbitrarily large, like each instruction can ask for any number of registers. Yeah, so then your hardware will become fairly complicated. That's the problem. If you think about it. Okay, so we haven't yet talked about the free list organization, so we'll soon talk about that. We'll see why there's a problem. Okay, so what does the map table look like? It's a multi-ported RAM. So we're talking about a table which maintains logical to physical register mapping. So if you've forgotten about the structure of this table, it looks like this. If I have n logical registers, it will have n entries. And if I have p physical registers, each entry will be log p bits wide. So a particular register X will have the corresponding physical register map stored in it. Okay. So it has 16 read ports and 4 write ports. So this is probably understandable, 4 write ports. Why is that?
Four registers taken by
instruction in a cycle. You will at most update 4 entries in this table, right? So you require 4 writes. Okay. So 4 write ports. Why do you have 16 read ports?
There are 4 stages in the pipeline which have used this register unit.
Oh really? Which stages?
After the fetch. After the decode. In decode phase, you assign these registers. So 4 of them are. No.
How many read ports should it have, you think? If I left it blank, X, let's say. What is X? It should be equal to the number of reads I can do in a cycle, right? From this table. How many do I do? How many reads? Forget about this number 16. Give me some number that makes sense to you. So let's suppose I'm renaming, let's pick an instruction from here. Let's say I'm renaming, these are bad instructions. I'll make up an instruction. Add R1, R2, R3. So what do I need from the table to rename this particular instruction? Now tell me which entries I'm going to read from the table for this instruction.
R2
and R3. Right? I'll read R2 and R3 to get the corresponding physical register IDs for this. Right? And I'll assign a new physical register to R1. Right? So I'll update R1 and I'll read R2 and R3. I have 4 such instructions. So how many read ports should I require? Sorry?
8.
Okay. So, is there anybody who thinks that we need more? So, I just say that you could have conditional add instructions, for example. C add Z, which would have 3 sources. So I can convert it to this kind of an instruction, right?
Still 12.
Then it becomes to 12, right? Now, MIPS doesn't have this instruction. MIPS has only one type of conditional instruction, that is conditional move. Conditional move instructions, as you can see, have just 2 sources. But I tell you that the conditional move instruction will still require to read R3 also from the table. Why is that?
Sir, is it for all the instructions, whether it is not a conditional move?
Yes.
Other instructions like add, simple, store, store. It will also need to read the last mapping of the destination.
Okay, all right. So he has raised a separate point. He says that in this instruction, forget about the conditional part of it, I also need to read the old map of R1. For example, suppose R1 was mapped to PK previously. Now I give it a new map. which is say pn. I need to read pk also. I just cannot write, overwrite pk with pn. Why is that? Can somebody answer? Why do I need to read the old map of the destination? So what I'm, right, so currently R1 is mapped to PK before that instruction is renamed. So I ask the prelist to give me one new register and it gives me PN. So now PK will be replaced by PN. But what he has said is that I also need to remember PK. So I need to read it. I just cannot overwrite PK with PN, forget about PK. Why is that? So why do I free PK? How long has it been allocated?
Until the instruction comes.
Which instruction?
The instruction that has the map PK for that particular
instruction. Instructions don't have maps. Registers have maps.
For this particular register, an earlier instruction had this.
That's right. The last instruction to produce R1 got PK. Yes. Okay.
So until that instruction comes. PK,
for sure. At the time, I can free PK. So you're saying that there was an instruction which produced R1 and we mapped R1 to PK at that time. And when that instruction commits, I can recycle PK and assign to somebody else.
If it is not used later, are you able to read it? Okay, we can't know that in future we get used, but if it's overwritten, like R1 is assigned to some other, then we can free it.
So when does it get free in this case?
Here, when we assign R1 and then
when you assign?
Two condition, one, the PK, previous uses of PK was committed. The instruction using PK.
How do you know that?
The instruction commits, we can know which involved PK. And
give me an algorithm for that. What would be a very simple algorithm? Recycle PK. You're right. So I should commit it when the last instruction to use PK has committed. How do I know what is the last instruction to use PK? And as you mentioned that once this instruction is inside the pipeline, I know that beyond this point, PK is dead, for sure, because R1 has now a new incarnation. But this instruction has a finite life inside the pipeline. It's not a point life, where it comes and goes. It starts here, goes to several pipe stages, and then completes. How do I know that during this time, there is still some instruction inside the pipeline which uses PK? There could be, right? Which is before that instruction. So when am I sure that PK will not be needed? Yeah?
When this instruction commits.
Exactly. So when this instruction commits, I know that everything before it has committed, and anything after it should not require PK, because R1 has now a new current. So it's very conservative, but it's correct. Okay. And this is the reason why this instruction needs to carry PK with it. So that when it finally commits, it can recycle PK. It will move PK to the previous bank. Okay, so that means I need 4 more extra reports. Because for every destination, I need to read its old map as well. Okay. So that makes it 12, right? I had 2 sources, which is 8 plus 4, 12. Now coming back to the previous question, I said that I need to read R3 here also for a different reason, not what he's mentioned. And if you can answer that, that will make it to 16. Because in a bundle, I can have 4 conditional move instructions. Why is it so? Think about how to implement conditional move. in front of every register you need a multiplexer. Is that correct? To be able to implement conditional boot. The multiplexing selection would be R1. And what do you write? What are the inputs to the multiplexer? I need two inputs. What are they? R3 and R2, right? So I either write the same content back to the register, or I write a new content. Right? That's what it means essentially. So R3 acts as a source as well in this instruction. So I have to read R3. I may write R3 to R3, or I may write R2 to R3, depending on finally what R1 is also, which I don't know what it is going to be at this point.
Can't we leave it unchanged? Why do we have to write it?
How do you design the register? Tell me. What is the hardware structure? There is no other way other than this actually. Okay.
So still can't we have some smart way to reduce the reports, because this is also using three.
We can reuse the same, the write port which we, so R3 is being written in this.
Does
that succeed?
Yes.
So
the R3 is being written always. That is my point.
No,
even if it fails, R3 will be written. Because this is the architecture, this is the hardware issue. Yeah. So you have to be prepared for the worst case. That is, a bundle contains four conditional move instructions. That's the worst possible scenario.
Still, then there will be 12 minutes.
No, plus what he has mentioned, right? I have to read.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
That is the same register.
Which one?
R3, the old mapping of.
Yeah, but how do you design the hardware? Yes. We looked at the SRAM ports, right? How is this designed? You have to have four separate word lines.
You are reading one register twice.
Twice, exactly. Yes. There's no other way. You give me the hardware, actually. I'll agree with you. Okay, so that's how you get 16 read ports. Okay. Yeah, so third operand is a condition bit. So we'll talk about this particular predicate bit. When we talk about register file, actually how it is done. But keep in mind that this is also renamed. Even if it's a bit, it's still renamed. Okay, all right. Well, I mean, yeah, so by bit, I mean it is a single bit value, but it's actually a full register. Okay, so it's pretty good register. Which is taken from the normal architecture register file. So any question on this? Is it clear? 16 read ports, 4 write ports. Okay. And yes, if you did not have conditional move instructions, you would have 12 read ports, which makes more sense. Good, right? Okay. But because of this, you have to have 4 extra ports. The renamer uses 24 5-bit comparators to resolve dependencies. What are these dependencies? So before trying to actually account for this particular number 24 here, can someone tell me what are these dependencies that you're talking about? So remember that we are currently in a piece of hardware which is trying to rename 4 instructions in parallel by looking up this particular table.
So before that, one more question with the map. So you have 16 read ports and 4 write ports.
Yeah.
And you are renaming actually 4 instructions.
That's right.
And these 4 instructions may itself, they may itself be dependent upon one another. So how does actually this, suppose that we read all the input dependencies first, that would
happen. No, I didn't tell you that you would.
Yeah. How is that done?
No, okay, first of all, can you give me an example where there might be a problem? So let's suppose to get you started, let's suppose the first instruction of the bundle is this. Yeah, so can you give me?
So the next instruction is writing, is using R1 and writing it on the register.
Would you mind if I write to the same register? just like these two instructions. Okay, I'm not reading them in parallel.
Yeah.
So what is the problem? So as you have mentioned, I cannot just go ahead and treat each instruction individually and say that, well, I'm going to read R2 and R3. I'm going to read R1 and R1. But that this instruction will get a wrong map. It should get the map that this instruction gets, actually. So this is the dependency you're talking about here. So now can somebody account for that number 24? We have four instructions. Yeah. And plus, so one problem that we discuss in this particular example, you also have to make sure that this map finally survives in the slot of R1. This should not. But there, so this order has also should be maintained. So even though you are renaming four things in parallel, there are certain order restrictions that have to be obeyed within this one, depending on the dependencies. So these comparators are trying to figure out these dependencies. So can somebody explain that number 24? That's right. Okay. So let's suppose that I have a bundle size of k. I have k instructions. Okay, right? And for the worst case, we have three sources per instruction. Because in a bundle, I can have k conditional move instructions. Okay, right? All right. So how many comparators do I need?
K into 3, k minus.
Exactly. So k into k minus 1 per operand. I have three operands, right? How do I get this? So if I take the first target, I compare it with next k minus 1 instructions. Take this target, I compare it with the next k minus 2 instructions. And for each instruction, I have three operands, okay, right? So if I plug in k equal to 4, I still don't get 24. I get slightly less than that, I get 18. By 2, sorry. What are the extra six comparators? So this is the raw dependence. What are the extra six comparators? Yeah? I still need to make sure that in this case that this map survives, not this one. Right after right, how many?
Only 4 choose 2.
Sorry?
4 choose 2.
So k into k minus 1 by 2, right? For the first target, I compare the next k minus 1 targets. This target, I compare the next k minus 2. K into k minus 1 over 2. So the total is twice k into k minus 1. All right, clear? So now the question is, how do I really implement this? Okay, I know how many comparators are, and I need to figure this out. So you can guess that there will be certain bypass paths within the rename stage that are actually operating, right? Which would actually pass on this R1 map to these guys so that whatever they have read from the table will finally get overridden by whatever they have read. So to be able to drive, so essentially what I'm saying is that the final map that it's going to get, this particular register source, will be either whatever it has read from the map table or something coming from one of the destinations earlier, right? So you have a multiplexer which will be having these two inputs, and its selection will be driven by one of these comparators output, or maybe a combination of that. Right? How do you organize the free list? It's four-way banked. Each bank is 8 entry people. So each bank's read pointer gives you a free register ID. So that's the simplest way to implement a free list that can give you four registers every cycle. say, four FIFOs. Right? So you consult the read pointer of each of the FIFOs, whatever they point to is your field register. All right, so after renaming, we are almost ready to issue. So what you do is, you assign an active list entry to every instruction. So this is essentially the reorder buffer. In MIFS, it's called an active list. The active list is a 32 entry FIFO queue, which keeps track of all in-flight instructions, which can be at most 32 in order. Each entry contains various information about allocated instructions, such as physical destination register number, etc. How do you organize the active list? Is it a single FIFO? Should it be broken down into a bunch of FIFOs? How do you decide that? So here, how do you decide this one? Four-way bank, eight-entry FIFO. Why not eight-way bank, four-entry FIFO? Why not 16-way bank, two-entry FIFO? Two-way bank, 16-entry FIFO. Why is this one, this particular one here? Why not just one FIFO with 32 entries? Well, okay. Okay, before that, that's an interesting question. Here we say that each register file has 64 registers. So would you expect your free list to be 64 entries?
You have two separate free lists.
Yes, you have two.
And at a time you assign, at a time you require only from a bank of 32 only. Because if it is an integer operation.
No. Each one has 64 registers.
So logically, there are only 32.
Okay.
So, on 32 only you will assign. Maybe there are more physical registers, but logically there are only.
Okay, maybe I have. Let me see. I'll ask you a general question. Suppose I have n logical registers and p physical registers. How big is my free list? Sorry?
N.
Not N minus P.
N.
N? N minus P. Which one is bigger?
P is bigger. This would be
P is bigger. Would you like to revise your answer?
P minus
P. T minus P. Why?
These are the 50 registers. No, it can be registered. It depends on how many registers are allocated.
Anything else? Login?
It could be less than P minus N. Because.
What is it?
Sir, so there are many instructions in the that waiting list. They are not basically.
Okay, maybe okay. That. So, what does a free list entry contain?
A physical register which could be used, which
right.
Is not.
It's an integer.
Yes.
A free list entry contains an integer, which could be used. So, the question is how do you size this free list? What is the maximum size?
P.
Why P minus?
There should be some initial map.
Initial map.
So at any point of time there will be some map. So you need the ones which are not mapped.
So what is the longest size of the free list? How do you prove that it's P minus? You are saying there are certain points in time there will be certain registers that are mapped.
At most n. Exactly n.
Exactly n.
Exactly n.
Okay,
all
right.
And at least
at T minus
N
or
3.
At max. So, are you a 3? initial, no, no, it might be my exactly because there might be dependencies for it's instructions which are not retired and are so basically they might be they might
so in the pipeline there could be multiple instructions that have mapped the same logical register.
Mm-hmm.
That's possible, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So there would be in a certain point in time there could be more than n logical registers that are mapped. Possible, right? Which means there could be more than n 3D spaces that are occupied. But what is the worst case? That's what you designed for, actually.
Are you assuming an initial mapping?
Well, when the machine boots up, something will be mapped.
Yes. Then should be KYC sufficient then.
Why?
Because there are three physical registers and n have already been mapped. So.
No, can you prove that n will always be mapped? At least n? Because we're looking for the worst case all the time. That's what we need really. The largest possible 3D size.
So when do you rename these to other registers? So you always rename it to some other physical register.
That's right.
You change the entry to some other physical register, so you have replaced one with one.
That's
so
right.
The number remains the same, P minus one.
Okay.
At least at max me, at least max me.
Okay, alright. Okay, so okay, essentially the argument is that at any point in time, at least n registers will remain mapped. If your pipeline is completely empty, processor is doing nothing, then you'll have n registers mapped to some physical registers, right? So the largest possible 3D size is never more than p minus n. And that's what we need to size for, right? So that explains why it is 32. Because it's 64 minus 32. Why is it organized like this?
There should be two free lists.
Yeah, there are two free lists, yeah. I'm just talking about one of them here. Both are organized in the same way. One integer free list, one floating point free list. Why is it organized like this?
Four write codes.
Four?
You require four renaming set at a time.
Yeah.
For four way bands, four bands.
Four
parallel, so you can rename them.
Why can't I do that in a single field?
Multiple ports.
Implementing this way, we can get the first free register at one time.
Right.
But if they are implemented in 32, let's we need one by one, we need to get the free registers.
I can design my hardware with four read ports. I'll keep four read pointers that will move synchronously. So I'll just, tell them that you can activate these four word lines, give me the contents. Done. What do I lose in that organization? I lose something compared to this. There I have a 32 entry RAM, which is 4-way ported. Here I have four RAMs, which are single ported, each of them. There will be a huge difference in latency of these two things. So that's why it is organized like this. And why four? Because I need four registers every cycle, as I mentioned. Okay. This is not about writing four things. I need to read four things from this people every cycle. Now, this works provided I also return four things to the list every cycle. Okay, so that also determines your commit rate. Because we return registers to the free list when instructions commit. Like I said, when this instruction commits, I free the old map of R1. Okay, right? That will now be returned to the free list.
Okay.
So I'll move the right pointer of the free of each of these maps. So four registers will be returned every cycle to the free list, at most four.
Okay,
so I hope you remember how a FIFO works. Right? It has a read pointer and a write pointer. Okay. So at the head and at the tail.
Okay.
Okay, now, so carrying this forward, how do you organize this FIFO? What determines the organization? What are the parameters? So how many bands should I have here? Is it 4 bands, 8 entries per bank? 16 bands, 2 entries per bank? What is it? 2 bands, 16 entries per bank? How do you decide that? So where do you read the active list entry? In what pipe stage? Sorry?
Decode.
What do you read from the active list entry in decode stage? Where do you write to the active list? Where do you write to the active list? Sorry? At each stage. Which stage?
Second stage, during the second stage.
Exactly. So that's what this first sentence says, right? During the second stage, every instruction is assigned an active list entry, which means I pick up an active list entry and write to it. Right? I fill up certain things in the active list entry. So how many active list entries do I need to write every cycle? How many instructions come into this stage every cycle?
Four.
Four instructions come in, four instructions leave. I need to write four things every cycle. So I need four write codes. What do I need from that list? The information that we're going in here will be needed when? For example, it says a physical destination register number.
In renaming, you don't map to these registers.
So, for example, in R1 here, right? It would store its old map in the active list. That's a place to remember, no? What is going to read it?
I check for renaming if it is not.
Sorry? Exactly. So, when the instruction commits, I'll require this particular number so that I can free the register. So number of read ports is determined by the commit, how many instructions are commit. And MIPS, that's also 4. So that basically tells me that I should have 4 bands. Each is an 8 entry field. So that I can read 8 things.
Every time of issue also we give this?
No, we don't. We'll carry the relevant relevant information along with us to the issue queue. Issue queue entry will store those things.
But at certain interval, we need to check whether this is now eligible to be executed.
Yeah, so those information will be stored in the issue queue entry. So ROV entry will also contain, for example, your branch outcome, so that you can update the branch predictor when the instruction commits. Okay. So anything that you write to this particular active list entry will be required at commit time. That's when you read that. Okay, so also each instruction is assigned to one of the three issue queue. Issue queues depending on its type. Integer queue holds the integer ALU instructions. Floating point queue holds the floating point instructions. And address queue holds the memory operations. Therefore, stage 2 may stall if the processor runs out of any of these resources, like active list entries, physical registers, or issue queue entries.